Grace and peace to you from God the Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. God's word for our consideration this morning is the gospel lesson from Matthew chapters 9 and 10. They're some of the most famous people in the history of the world. All I have to do is say the 12, and you know I'm talking about the disciples. And yet, even though they are as famous as they are, and even though we just heard their names read, many of us would have a hard time repeating all of their names from memory. Matthew, yeah, John, Peter, but Thaddeus, Simon the Zealot, James, son of Alphaeus, a few of us would have trouble remembering them. It's kind of strange the knowledge we have about the disciples. We know a fair amount about them as a group, but relatively little about them as individuals, especially certain ones of those individuals, those names that are harder to remember. And some of what we think we know about them might actually be wrong. There's a fair amount of knowledge about the disciples not from Scripture, but from church tradition. For example, church tradition tells us that all of the disciples, except for John and Judas, were martyred, meaning they were killed specifically because of their faith. Church tradition actually has a fair amount of detail about Peter was forced to watch his wife be killed, and then he was crucified. Upside down at his request, because he didn't think he was worthy of being crucified in the same way his Lord was. His brother, Andrew, again according to tradition, was nailed to a slanted cross where he suffered for 3 days before finally dying. We know for sure that James, the brother of John, was martyred because the Bible actually does tell us about that. With Bartholomew, again, all we have is tradition, which says that he was skinned alive and then crucified upside down. And the other James, tradition says, was thrown off a high point and beaten to death with clubs. Are those stories true? Maybe, maybe not. Tradition is not God's word. God's word is authoritative without error. Tradition is certainly not. On the other hand, those specific traditions are quite old. They were written down by some of our earliest church fathers, the men who learned from the apostles themselves, or maybe one generation later. It's fairly reliable, in my opinion. Let's imagine, though, for a second that it's absolutely true. All those ways in which those men were martyred, it's true. Now let's pretend that we could go to them and ask them. So, were your horrific deaths the worst part, the most difficult part of your ministries? Obviously, we can't say for sure how they would answer it. I'm sure they would affirm that it was terrible to die that way. But my feeling, my suspicion, is that at least some of them would say, no, that wasn't really the hardest part of my ministry. The hardest part of my ministry was, and then they would tell us something more mundane, more of those everyday challenges of being disciples, apostles, pastors, missionaries. All those titles really apply to those men. Things like preaching to people who didn't seem to listen or hear what they were saying. Living in relative poverty while the people who had first heard the gospel from their lips lived in wealth and comfort. Watching people and congregations slide backward spiritually instead of moving forward in their faith lives. And I'm confident moment they would mention the shame that they felt as they didn't live up to their calling to be God's messengers. I think they'd have all sorts of stories for us. Stories about how doing gospel ministry involves getting your hands dirty in a lot of different ways. And that's my message to you today, too. Get your hands dirty. Our lesson begins with Jesus doing just that, getting his hands dirty, preaching, teaching, healing. The people of Galilee, the northern region, and these people were not easy to minister to. We talked last week about how when Jesus came, the religion of the Jews was pretty much dead. And it's not just because these people didn't immediately recognize Jesus as the Messiah, but it's also that many of the truths of the religion God had given to them, they had lost, they had thrown away. They basically followed a religion of legalism and work righteousness. So they were not easy to minister to. Really, they were unbelievers that Jesus was ministering to. He would have had every right to look at those people and reject them, just as they had rejected his Father, just as they were rejecting him. But that's not who our Jesus is. Once I've been at Divinity for years and years and years, some of you will probably begin to smirk or elbow each other when you hear me talk about the Greek word agape, love. I tend to talk about that a lot. But also one of the ones we have in this lesson, my second favorite Greek word that shows up in the New Testament. The way it's translated just fine here. It says in verse 36, when he saw the crowds, he was moved with compassion. Moved with compassion. What that Greek word actually means is that literally Jesus' guts were moved inside of him. See, the ancient people thought of the intestines and the liver as the seat of emotions, kind of like we think of the heart that way. You know, my heart was broken. And so what happened here, what Jesus felt, is something like gut-wrenching sympathy. His heart broke for the people. Just an amazing, amazing detail that shows the love of our Savior. He looked at these terrible, sinful unbelievers, and instead of rejecting them as he could have, he felt so badly for them that he could feel it in his guts. It hurt inside of him to see them lost. Sheep without a shepherd. And so he began shepherding to them. Getting his hands dirty. Whenever we read, at least oftentimes when I read, about Jesus reaching out to those lost sheep in Israel, or later the apostles reaching out to the lost sheep of the Roman world, there's a couple of thoughts that can easily occur to us. Number one, how terribly sad, how ridiculous, really, that God's own people, the Jews, who had every spiritual advantage, didn't recognize Jesus for who he was. But also, another thought that can occur, how amazing that they had so many outreach opportunities, so many mission opportunities right outside their back door, right outside their front door. So many of the people they saw every day were unbelievers that they could share the gospel with. That must have been exciting. But that's not how it is for us. I hope you know that's very much wrong. There are more prospects today than there were in Jesus, more than there were in Paul's day. Yes, this city is named after an apostle, but there are thousands upon thousands of unbelieving lost sheep just on the east side of St. Paul. And in the greater region, hundreds of thousands. So where do we start? Well, as Jesus says, we start, get your hands dirty, by praying for them. Now, how is that getting your hands dirty? Well, in a number of ways. Number one, praying for the lost is getting your hands dirty because of who you're praying for. These are not always the most likable people in our lives. Are you ready to pray for your crass coworker, your unbelieving, militantly atheist neighbor, your sacrilegious relative who seems to enjoy offending you, poking you where you're most sensitive when it comes to your faith? That's hard work. That's getting your hands dirty, praying for people that are not the most naturally likable in the world. But it's also getting our hands dirty because of who we are. The same sin resides in us. And when we pray for the lost, Satan is ready to attack us, to suggest, to condemn us for being arrogant enough to think we should pray for others. It's hard work. It's dirty work, praying for the lost. The prayer specifically that Jesus encourages his disciples to pray and us to pray is for the work to be done. What is that work? Well, it's mentioned a couple of times. First of all, it says Jesus, in verse 35, was preaching the gospel of the kingdom. And then later, he says, as you approach, preach this message. The kingdom of heaven is near. That's the work. Preaching the message of the kingdom of heaven. In other words, the gospel. Preaching law to those who need to hear law. Gospel to those who need to hear gospel. That, my friends, is dirty work. We have it, I think, so easy, so comfortable, that we maybe got a little soft when it comes to spiritual work. We're afraid of getting our hands dirty. Are you ready to really give the gospel to others? That's dirty work. Because it means you have to love them. If you're going to give them the one thing they need, that means you have to love them. Love sinful people. People who by nature reject Jesus. Reject the thing that's most important to you. Are you ready to get your hands dirty by giving them the gospel? It's difficult, dangerous work, even. Are you ready to swallow your pride? Because you might get mocked for it. That's often part of the deal, part of the package. That those we are trying to save will mock us, will make fun of us for what we believe. Get your hands dirty. And what's required for that is love. If you read what the apostles wrote, those New Testament writings, think of specifically John. Look at John's epistles and how often he talks about love. Love, 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 love. It's the only way that we can really get our hands dirty is by loving. How do you do that? How do you get that love? By remembering, by meditating, by believing upon how Jesus got his hands dirty for you. Hands encased in mud and blood, hands pierced by iron, hands buried in a tomb. That's Jesus' love for you. That's the love we are to have for others. Get our hands dirty by praying for the lost, by giving them the gospel, but also by supporting called workers. Because you can't do all of this by yourself, can you? It's impossible. Jesus sent out the 12, he sends out others. Because each individual Christian can't do it by himself or herself. Let's remember where those called workers come from. In Ephesians, Paul writes, it was he, that is Jesus, who gave some to be apostles, some to be prophets, some to be evangelists, some to be pastors and teachers. It's a really important Christian doctrine that we don't really think about a whole lot until a pastor takes a call and you've got to get another pastor. The doctrine of the divine call is the doctrine of comfort. It's comforting to me that Jesus is the one who put me here. I didn't seek out this job, I didn't apply for it, I didn't interview for it. And that's comforting because when things go wrong, and they do, when I make mistakes, and I certainly do, I can take comfort in the fact that, well, it's not like I made a mistake in coming here. Jesus is the one who put me here, and he must have a good reason. But boy, is that comforting for you too. You didn't, at least I don't think you did, you didn't send out a team to observe different pastors preaching before you figured out which one you'd call. You didn't interview me, you didn't interview others. You trusted the process, you trusted the Holy Spirit. You know that for very good reasons, over the years, the Lord of the church has given you the pastors and teachers that you have had in your lives. And how comforting that is for you too. Because I'm sure all workers have let you down. Pastors have put their feet in their mouths and offended you. But you didn't go home then and think, boy, we got the wrong pastor. You maybe struggled with it, but you didn't think we got the wrong pastor. You had that comfort knowing God gave us that pastor. God gave my children that teacher who may not be perfect, but she was put there by Jesus. Support your called workers. Financially, Jesus refers to that. The worker deserves his support. But there's another form of supporting called workers, and that's praying for them as well. That's encouraging them. Don't hesitate to encourage pastors and teachers. You never know when that little word of encouragement was just what that individual needed. When they were struggling with thoughts of failure in ministry. But remember where that and when that encouragement starts. Way before the call is extended. That encouragement starts with the many young men and women, boys and girls we have in our congregation who have the gifts for ministry. They just need to be encouraged. Most of you know even better than I do the young people in our congregation who have those gifts. And as a called worker, I can tell you, I would not be where I was if it wasn't for kind souls in my home congregation who encouraged me again and again. Get your hands dirty by talking to those young people and encouraging them to get their hands dirty. For Jesus, for the lost, and for the church. Amen. Now may the Lord of peace himself give you peace at all times and in every way. Amen.